Thank you, Mark, and good morning. As Mark said, this is a combination of services, and so it's a sort of special day out of the year that we take to give special attention to our Lord and His birth, and so that's what we're going to do this morning in terms of our sermon. I've chosen a familiar text for this season of the year, Isaiah chapter 7, verse 14. The whole chapter is going to bear on the sermon, but I'm going to concentrate on verse 14 and 15, but we'll read verses 10 through 16. This was a time of great crisis for the nation Judah. As you know, the nation at the time of Isaiah was divided into two kingdoms, the northern kingdom, which was Israel, and the southern kingdom, which was Judah, and Judah was under siege from the north. We read, "Then the Lord spoke again to Ahaz, saying, 'Ask a sign for yourself from the Lord your God. Make it as deep as Sheol or high as heaven.' But Ahaz said, 'I will not ask, nor will I test the Lord.' Then he said, 'Listen now, O house of David. Is it too slight a thing for you to try the patience of men, that you will try the patience of my God as well? Therefore, the Lord himself will give you a sign. Behold, a virgin will be with child and bear a son, and she will call his name Emmanuel. He will eat curds and honey at the time he knows enough to refuse evil and choose good. For before the boy will know enough to refuse evil and choose good, the land whose two kings you dread will be forsaken.'" May the Lord bless this reading of His Word and bless our time of studying it together. Let's bow in prayer. One of the carols we often hear at this season is titled, "What Child Is This?" Set to the tune of "Green Sleeves." It's a beautiful hymn that asks an important question. Who or what is Jesus? Lots of answers have been given to that. German theologian Friedrich Schleiermacher defined Jesus as archetypal man. The Russian novelist Leo Tolstoy was more down to earth. He called Christ the greatest of all ethical teachers, an answer as old as the rich young rulers who called him good teacher. A few decades ago, liberation theologians were speaking of Jesus as a political figure, a liberator and revolutionary. None of these are the answer the Bible gives to the question, "What child is this?" That answer is found all over Scripture for any who want to know it, but nowhere more simply stated than in Isaiah chapter 7, verse 14. It's the name given to the child, Emmanuel. One word, but a word filled with volumes of knowledge and encouragement. It means God with us. And it was given as a message of hope. It was given at a time of great uncertainty and distress. Ahaz was king of Judah, and Judah was at war. Isaiah 7, verses 1 through 9 describe the events surrounding this prophecy and this sign. Two kings had formed an alliance, the king of Syria and the king of Israel. Their plan was to overthrow Ahaz and install a ruler of their choice on the throne of Judah. It looked as though they might succeed. They had defeated the armies of Judah, they had taken captives, and they had reached the walls of Jerusalem. Ahaz was terrified. Verse 2 describes his heart and those of the people as being like trees shaking in the wind. So in a panic, he did everything he could to prepare for a long siege. One day he went out to inspect and fortify the city. That's when God sent the prophet to him with a message of hope. Isaiah approached Ahaz with encouraging words. "Take care," he said. and be calm, have no fear, and do not be faint-hearted, because the two kings are just smoke. Together they made a powerful army, but they would not overthrow the king. The Lord would overthrow them and save Jerusalem and Ahaz. So the king was to trust the Lord for that. But Ahaz was not a man to do that. He was not a man of faith. He had every reason to be, at least humanly speaking. He was the grandson of Uzziah, Judah's great and godly king. But Ahaz was ungodly, wicked, and a man of the world. So when he found himself in danger, rather than look up to heaven for help, he looked east to Assyria. He trusted in man. But in doing so, he was making a deal with the devil. Assyria would become an enemy worse than the two kings he feared. The Lord is patient. He knows our nature. He knows our weakness. He knows we are just dust. So to help Ahaz trust him, in verse 11, he offered to give him a sign. He could make it as big as he wanted, as deep as Sheol, as high as heaven. Ask the Lord to turn the sun to sackcloth and the moon to blood. Ask him to shake the earth, to cast a mountain into the sea. Test the Lord, and he will prove himself able and faithful. Whatever Ahaz needed to help his unbelief, the Lord would do. It was his for the asking. But Ahaz rejected the offer and instead said, "I will not ask, nor will I test the Lord." He was actually quoting scripture in that, Deuteronomy 6, verse 16, "You shall not put the Lord to the test." It sounded noble, but it was a sham. The Lord told him to put him to the test. So not doing what the Lord said to do was testing the Lord. The reason Ahaz rejected the offer was not piety. It was unbelief. He trusted in men, not God. He didn't want the evidence God offered because his mind was already made up. That's typical. In his commentary on the book of Isaiah, John Oswalt said, "Evidence cannot create faith, it can only confirm it. Where there is not faith, evidence is merely unwelcome, something which needs to be explained away." That's so true. And that's what men spend their lives doing. The natural evidence for God is everywhere, but men refuse to see it. The historical evidence for Christ, for his birth, his death, his resurrection is abundant, but men ignore it. The result is tragic because when men reject the light, they choose the darkness. They reject wisdom, and the only thing left is folly. So they follow a path that leads to destruction. John Wesley said, "If a man will not believe God, he will believe anything." Ahaz was like that. He was ready to believe anything, even that an evil, rapacious nation like Assyria could be a trusted friend. So he shut the door on God. It was a sad moment, but it was also a great moment. God makes the wrath of man to praise him, as the psalmist said. And he used Ahaz's refusal to seek a sign to give a sign of his own, one of the greatest signs and revelations ever given. Isaiah announced, "Behold, a virgin will be with child and bear a son, and she will call his name Emmanuel." Who is this child, and what is this child? The apostles identified him as Jesus, the Son of God, and they interpreted this verse as a prophecy of his birth. In modern times, that interpretation has been rejected, and the child has been identified as a contemporary of Ahaz, maybe his son Hezekiah, or perhaps a child that would be born to Isaiah, Isaiah had some children who are prominent in the early chapters of this book, and they have interesting names, so perhaps that would be the one who would have the child. Verse 16 might seem to support that and imply that the child was a contemporary with the prophecy that before he would know the difference between good and evil, the two kings would be forsaken. But that can simply mean that the threat of the two kings would last no longer than it would take for the child to be born in the future to choose right from wrong. In other words, it's simply a way of saying that the threat would be short-lived. Everything about him, his name and his mother, indicates that this is a prophecy about a unique child who would have a miraculous birth and be greater than any child ever born. The word translated virgin is the Hebrew word alma, which can simply mean young woman. That's how it is translated in the Revised Standard Version, which again casts doubt on the virgin birth. But Alma can also mean a young girl who is a virgin. And it always refers to an unmarried woman. That would exclude the wives of Ahaz or Isaiah and their children. There are other Hebrew words for woman and young woman that Isaiah could have used if that were his meaning. But if Isaiah intended to describe the unique condition of an unmarried virgin who would be with child, then the best word for that is this word that he uses, Alma, which is well translated virgin. And the only child who had such a mother is Jesus. And again, that's how the apostles interpret this great passage. It's quoted, for example, in Matthew chapter 1, verse 23, of Mary and the son she would bear, whose name was to be called Jesus, because he would save his people from their sins. And the next chapters of Isaiah support that, because they develop the story of this child who is clearly unique. In chapter 9, he is identified with four names. So other names are added to this name, Emmanuel. He would be Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Eternal Father, Prince of Peace. About this same time, the prophet Micah foretold that out of Bethlehem would come a ruler in Israel whose goings forth are from long ago, from the days of eternity. The eternal king of Micah chapter 5 verse 2 is the eternal father of Isaiah 9 verse 6 and Emmanuel of Isaiah 7:14, a unique child. None of this could be said of Hezekiah or anyone else of that day, and no one else in the Old Testament bears any of these names. That can only be a prophecy of the birth of Jesus Christ, and it reveals much about him. So, what child is this? Well, the next two verses, verses 14 and 15, answer that. Obviously, the first thing that stands out about the Lord is here in verse 14, his unusual birth. Jesus was born of a virgin. Behold, a virgin will be with child and bear a son. Christ entered the world miraculously. But the miracle is not really found in the birth. That was completely natural, in that the Lord developed in the womb of his mother and he came forth as we all do. He was born of a virgin because he was supernaturally conceived. We speak of the virgin birth. I think it's proper to do that. But it is probably more accurate to speak of the virgin conception. And that's where the mystery lies. In Luke chapter 1, when the angel Gabriel came to Mary and told her that she would bear the Messiah, she said, "How can this be since I am a virgin?" She couldn't understand how this could happen. So Gabriel answers her question in a way that explains enough while not explaining everything. He says, the Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. And for that reason, the holy offspring shall be called the Son of God. What was involved with overshadowing? It's a mystery. But through it, the second person of the Godhead, the Son of God, received a human nature from Mary to become a son of man. As John said, the Word became flesh. And the genuineness of his humanity must never be minimized, as has happened at various times in history. Some of the early heretics denied the humanity of Christ altogether. Even today, Christians sometimes tend to minimize the humanity of Christ in favor of his deity, and that's understandable in that the liberal theologians and the skeptics of the world have denied his deity, and so we tend to focus upon that. But the Bible is clear that he was a genuine man with, as the Catechism puts it, a true body and a reasonable soul. Paul put it plainly in Romans 8 and verse 3, where he wrote that God sent his Son in the likeness of sinful flesh. Now you'll notice it's not in the likeness of flesh. His flesh was real. It was like yours and mine, but it was in the likeness of sinful flesh. It bore the frailties that we do due to sin, though without sin. He would thirst and hunger and have fatigue. He would have all of those conditions, yet it was not because he was sinful. He was not. His flesh or human nature was real. It was like ours, of the same stuff we are made of, only without sin. And Isaiah indicates that here in verse 15, where he prophesied that he would know to refuse evil and choose good. He always did that. He always refused the evil and chose the good. He was the perfect man who, as Peter said, went about doing good. That's what characterized his life. He was both perfect man and holy God, and he came into this world in this amazing and mysterious way by the Holy Spirit and through the womb of a virgin. There is a great mystery in that which we can never fully comprehend. The Son of God, who is the creator and sustainer of the universe, became a tiny embryo in the womb of a young girl while never ceasing to be God. Spurgeon called this child of a virgin a marvelous sight. There, he wrote, is the finite and the infinite. There is the mortal and the immortal. The august maker come to tabernacle on this speck of earth, the vast unbounded one whom earth could not hold and the heavens cannot contain, lying in his mother's arms. He who fastened the pillars of the universe and riveted the nails of creation, hanging on a mortal breast, depending on a creature for nourishment. Veiled in flesh, the Godhead see, hail the incarnate deity. Spurgeon is right. It is a marvelous sight. Now, second, notice his food in verse 15, curds and honey. It's a simple diet, a diet of poverty and privation. In verse 22, it is what would be eaten when the land was devastated by war. And that fits the Lord's life. He is a king. He's the King of Kings, but he was born into poverty. He grew up as a man, sharing the struggles common to man. He knows what it is to be a man, what it is to experience hardship and trials and testing, to be rejected and alone. He knows what it is to walk through the valley of the shadow of death. He knows what it is to live by faith and trust the Heavenly Father for the things of life. He knows our experiences because he became truly one of us. He had to be one of us in order to be our Savior. Only a man could be the Savior of mankind, because only another human could stand as the substitute of men and women in judgment and take the penalty that we all deserve, but take it in our place. Jesus was uniquely qualified to do that because he was a sinless man, so he was able to bear our sins as our substitute. He had none of his own to pay for. And he was able to offer to God a sacrifice for a vast number of people because he is God and man, making his offering, his sacrifice of infinite value and eternal effect. He is Emmanuel, God with us, the revelation of God. No man has seen God at any time, but God revealed himself to the world in his Son when he became a man. The one who went about doing good, as Peter said, shows us the goodness of God, reveals his power, reveals his wisdom, his justice, and his faithfulness, reveals God's great attributes. He did that in both his life and his death, particularly in his death, because at the cross, Christ revealed the sacrificing, saving love of God, who loved us so much that he sacrificed his own Son for us. That's what Emmanuel reveals. It is a deeply theological name and a highly encouraging name. It defines Christ as more than man, defines him as the God-man, and it encourages us with the truth that he is with us. An important name, and yet nowhere in Scripture do we find him being called by that name. Until we come to the end of Matthew's gospel and read the Lord's final words where he applies the name to himself. In Matthew 28, verses 19 and 20, the Lord sends the disciples out into the world in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Then he encourages them with the words, "And lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age." He is God the Son, very God of very God, who would be with them always. That is Emmanuel. And the Lord, in effect, called himself that by applying this name to himself. What a hopeful statement that is. Wherever they went, whatever circumstance they were in, they would know that he was with them. And they had previous experiences that they could recall that gave meaning to his words and the promise that he gave about being with them, as they, for example, could recall when they were in the boat with him on the sea in a storm. All seemed lost. They were being tossed about on the waves, helpless against the elements, as the boat began to fill with water. And during all of this, the Lord was asleep in the back. Finally, in desperation, the disciples woke him and cried, "Teacher, do you not care that we are perishing?" Without a word, he rose, rebuked the wind and the waves. The storm died. The sea became calm, and the Lord said to them, "Why are you afraid? How is it that you have no faith?" He could have added, "You men are like old King Ahaz, no faith." The disciples were gripped with holy fear and asked one another, "Who then is this that even the wind and the sea obey him?" The one who was with them in the boat in the storm was God, Emmanuel. And because he was, they were as safe on the stormy sea as they were on the dry land. when they had a multitude to feed and only 5 loaves and 2 fish, Christ provided a banquet in the wilderness. Nothing's too difficult for him. When they were unable to cast out a demon from a child who was cruelly tormented by it, he came and cast it out and restored the boy to his father and to a sound mind. He's Lord over the elements. He's Lord over the spirits, over sickness and death, because he is God the Creator. And he's sympathetic toward us because he has shared our experiences. As the disciples would reflect on that and remember these and many, many other experiences, they knew they would be safe as they went out into the world, out into a hostile world to be his witnesses. He would be with them. He was there. Not to prevent the storms of life, not to keep those things from happening that so trouble us, but to protect in the storms and to provide in them and to give guidance and help that they needed in troubled times, in difficult and challenging times. The Lord doesn't promise us an easy life, just the opposite. But he does promise to be with us and to help us. He did that for them, for the 12. He did that for the Apostle Paul. Amazingly, toward the end of his life, Paul was largely a forgotten man. He told Timothy in 2 Timothy chapter 1 that all in Asia had turned away from him. It was the scene of his great ministry in Ephesus, for example. And all had turned away from him when he stood trial in Rome the first time and his life was on the line. He stood alone. All deserted me, he said. Think of that. The Apostle Paul, abandoned. No one cared about him. The greatest of God's people know what that is. They know what it is to be abandoned by friends, but none of them know what it is to be abandoned by God. And Paul went on to tell Timothy, "But the Lord stood with me and strengthened me." Nothing has changed over the millennia. Jesus Christ is the same yesterday and today and forever. Circumstances change, but he never changes. He will always stand with us. That is the assurance that we have. He has walked where we walk. And because he became a man, he has experienced what we experience. He knows what it is to be rejected by men. He knows what it is to be abandoned by friends and to stand alone. He knows what it is to be hungry in a desert. He knows our hardships. He knows what it is to experience temptation. In fact, he experienced it to the full. He sees what we are experiencing every day, and he is with us to provide for us in the midst of the difficulties. So when you're alone at night and feel abandoned, you are not. You never are and never will be. The Lord is always with his people in every circumstance and at every moment. We need to know that and draw close to him. We are to think about him. We are to fellowship with him through prayer and through the study of Scripture. We're to walk by faith. We are to trust him daily, not like Ahaz, that faithless king who leaned on the arm of the flesh and refused to test God, refused to trust God and believe his promises. So often, we are like unbelieving Ahaz. We need to know the promises of God's word. We need to know them, we need to believe them, we need to act upon them, apply them, be faithful. Or we will only live frustrated, anxious lives. In times of difficulty, we are to test the Lord by obeying his word. When we do, we will find that he is always reliable. He never fails us. He is always with us. So as we remember the birth of Jesus in this Christmas season, we should ask ourselves, what child is this? And remember the name that answers that question, Emmanuel, God with us. And remember His promise that He is with us through the dark valleys, through lonely nights, with us when we face challenging decisions, with us when we're having joyful times, peaceful times, because He's the author of that as well. He's always with us, even to the end of the age. So live with that assurance and promise. Walk by faith in it. And if there are any here who don't know Christ as their Savior, perhaps this is something new to you. You've never considered it. Consider it. Consider what child this is, who he is. Consider what he became as a man and what he did, and come to him. Trust in him as the one who died for sinners and saves all who believe in him. The moment you do, the moment you believe, your guilt and sin are taken away. You are clothed in the righteousness of Christ and you are given life everlasting. In this season of giving, that is the greatest gift of all. May God help you to know that, help you to do that, help you, each of us, to rejoice in the salvation that is ours in our Savior, who has promised to never leave us or forsake us, who will always be with us, who is our Emmanuel. We're going to move now into the second part of our service with the Lord's Supper, the remembrance of his birth, his death, his humanity and deity, his suffering for us through the bread and the wine as it symbolizes that. But as we do, let's join in singing hymn number 41 in the Songs of Praise book, Behold the Lamb, and then remain standing for, then we will be seated for the Lord's Supper. Let's stand and sing hymn number 41.